You swear that the testimony you are about to give this committee is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, to help you, God?
I do.
Please take a seat. Senator Eavis, it's your time.
Gregory Hirsch, executive assistant to Tom Wamsgans, correct?
Yes. Yes, if it is to be said.
I'm sorry?
If it is to be said, so it be. So it is.
Are you all right?
Yes. I merely wish to answer in the affirmative fashion.
You can speak to us normally.
Okay. No, thank you, sir. So I shall.
TBTL!
Can't you say anything in a normal way?
The answer, sadly, is not yes.
What I like to do is first lay down a kind of syncopated beat that isn't so much about what it is altogether. It's more about the modulation and what it is once it starts. It's a little bit of a groove.
You have no reflexes, your blood tastes like root beer, and some of your bones appear to have vanished.
He's a hot tomato.
I don't know what a hot tomato is.
Whatever happened to that wonderful man who was in here last week wearing that funny-looking turtleneck, singing that dumb song, wearing that smelly aftershave lotion? Whatever happened to him?
He was too beautiful to live.
All right, hello, good morning, and welcome everyone to a Monday edition of TBTL, the show that just might be too beautiful to live.
Here we go again.
My name is Luke Burbank. I am your host.
I like turtles.
Coming to you from the Madrona Hill studio, perched high above the mighty Columbia.
If only we were trapped in a castle in the middle of winter with nowhere to go.
I am definitely trapped in a snowy cottage here. Looking out at, I don't know, a good 6 inches of snow that is not going anywhere. I did go outside this morning and do a significant amount of snow shoveling. I have a weird thing anytime I'm snow shoveling, which is I get worried that I'm going to go into cardiac arrest. And that's not something I should probably be overly afraid of. I have decent cardio for my age. But you hear stories this time of year about so many people out shoveling snow and then keeling over. And so the entire time, and I wasn't shoveling like that much, but while I'm shoveling snow, all I'm thinking is, don't have a heart attack, don't have a heart attack, don't have a heart attack, because the TBTL listeners need you to bring them episode 4019 in a collector series.
Let the fun begin.
So here we are. Bringing you the episode that you so richly desire and richly deserve. Over the weekend, NBC was very, very proud of their accomplishment of forcing a record number of people to watch a football game via streaming. They were bragging about it.
I won't trash talk. I won't be out there blowhard.
They had a whole video package celebrating the fact that they strong-armed us all into something, which we'll play for you coming up. Speaking of television, I watched a lot of television this weekend, trapped here in this cottage in the snow, and I found a whole new way to enjoy television.
I love television. I've got to have that thing on 24/7. I love the patter.
It's a thing that probably most of you listeners have already been doing for many years, but it revolutionized my experience, and we will talk about that too. Plus, we'll talk to this guy, the longest-running Cobra of the show, maybe best known for his depictions of the tall ships. America woke up this morning wondering what he did this weekend.
Did you take a nap? Did you build a snowman? Did you catch a mouse? What did you do?
He's Andrew Walsh, and he's joining me right now. Good morning, my friend.
Is that how you stave off a heart attack? I didn't realize that. You just say over and over again, don't have a heart attack?
Uh-huh. Yep, it's been working for me out here on the Madrona Hill studio. I really did have... Well, here's the truth. I've been having... As I get older, I have more and more thoughts about what is my level of physical safety, particularly when I'm alone up here, which is most of the time. So I was putting up some shelves this weekend. I was trying to make it a very productive weekend since I wasn't going to be going anywhere. And I was up on a stepladder putting these floating shelves up. And I was standing on the stepladder and I was kind of leaning over the television because one of the shelves goes above where the TV is. And I had this thought. Is this how it ends? Does this ladder kick out from under me? This just happens so often in movies, right? Like that's just, it's this, these kind of very, what's the word, banal ways that people sometimes leave this planet. Like, hey, he was putting up a floating shelf. He was standing 3 feet off the ground on a snowy Saturday. And that's, you know, when the ladder kicked over. Or even this morning I woke up and I realized I had slept kind of funny and I have sort of a sore neck. And I didn't know how bad it was going to be, like if it was going to be the kind of muscle spasm where you kind of can't do anything. And I thought, I'm all alone up here. There's 6 inches of snow. The road is not plowed. Like, am I in some sort of danger from that? And of course I wasn't. I just took some ibuprofen. And then I was out here shoveling snow this morning. And again, I had the thought, I wasn't even getting that winded, but I thought, is this how it ends? Am I just shoveling snow and then I have a cardiac event? And then I keel over like in some Coen Brothers film, just me wearing too much snow gear, lying alone in a snowdrift.
Well, I need to get out in front of something here. I wanted to make a little, not even joke, just a reference to a film. And of course it's me, so I can't think of the name of it. So I just
Rango
Googled,
2?
So I just Googled Rango 2. I'm trying to see if I can call it up. I just Googled movies where teens die in interesting ways, and I didn't.
Oh God!
Yeah, it just occurred to me that I didn't have that on private when I Googled that. So that's attached to my, or what do you call it? What do you call the little? Gosh darn it! I'm bad with words. When you open up a browser, but it's private. It's like incognito is the word.
Oh
I was
sure.
For.
Well,
I
that's
did not
listen
do this
in your defense. Not all the different web browsers have different names for that kind of thing. There's private browsing, there's incognito, there's so don't beat yourself up. That's not the industry standard. I think that's like Google's. Is that Chrome?
That'd be Chrome. So I could have just stuck with private there. But what movie am I thinking of? And I hate to put you on the spot, but it's the one where
Final Destination.
That's literally it. I was trying to think of a final, like you like trying to affix that shelf above the television, that sort of scene. Uh-huh. But then it's not that, right? Like it seems it's setting you up to think you're
going
to fall.
As the viewer, we're watching
right.
Luke's life and we're like, oh, this is when it happens.
Right, exactly.
And then it's like, and then he just installs the floating shelf. And then just gets down and goes and eats some warmed up soup.
And then has a heart attack on the toilet.
Well, that's always a danger for me, believe you
right.
me.
Yeah.
But again, I don't want to worry the listeners. I think that happens too frequently on the show. But like,
sure,
it's interesting. It's an interesting experience living here where I live. I'm certainly not in the wilderness, but I'm not like right near emergency services. And again, there is still so much snow that is out here. And I will mention, Andrew, my neighbor, yesterday, I was, again, in my many projects, I decided to really channel, I think, you and do the world's most thorough cleaning of the sliding glass door in the living room that goes out to the deck.
Yeah.
Because it's never been cleaned. Like, they were installed, and then for the last 6 months, my dad and I and other people have just been working in the area. So there's all manner of dust and dirt and grime, and I was kind of waiting until most of the real messy construction work was done to actually invest the time of like cleaning out the little tracks, the run, you know what I mean? Just going to town on it. Mm-hmm. I spent 2 hours yesterday cleaning two 12-foot sliding glass doors. I mean, it was like trying to repaint the Sistine Chapel or something. But as I was doing that, I noticed my neighbor, Brian, he's got a tractor and he was out like snow plowing. He was out clearing his driveway and stuff. And I waved at him because I don't know. He's my neighbor and he kind of waved back. He's like he's a very nice but also fairly serious fellow.
He kind of waved back. He kind of like two fingers just sort of gently the sort of.
Well, what it was I did two waves at him and I couldn't, like the first wave, I lean out my door and I see him and I wave and he doesn't wave back. And then I'm like, does that because he didn't see me? And then I wave again.
Yeah.
And then he kind of raises one hand.
Like, yeah.
And I'm going, did he see the first wave and was like, I'm driving a tractor in the snow. I don't need to wave at you.
Or gave you an imperceptible nod that you didn't see from across the way. And then he's like, God,
or did
this
he only
guy
see
really
the second
needs-
wave like this?
Oh, yeah.
And part of this is a whole other thing. When I first started living out here and when I first became acquainted with my neighbor, who, again, I actually really like, he invited me over a number of times to like, just, hey, grab a beer and we'll kind of catch up. And, you know, he basically was being neighborly, and it just kept being like a scheduling problem. Like I'd have to be out of town or I'd be in the midst of something here. So I basically turned it down a few times, and then he was kind of like, we'll catch up when we catch up. And now it's just been kind of like, I don't want to say radio silence, but I'm a little worried that I kind of offended him in some way. But anyway, I see he's out there snow plowing, and I just give him a wave like, hey, neighbor, you know, we got a lot of snow going on. And then I realize this morning when I look out my front door that in plowing his driveway, he's created a huge embankment that blocks in my driveway.
Oh, really? I mean, I can totally picture what you're talking about. Like the city snow plows used to do that to us in Concord all the time. Then you have to go out there and shovel that really heavy plowed snow away.
It's not as bad as like you're describing. It's not like up to the waist, but it's like up to your knee.
He seems like a very conscientious neighbor and seems to be very like into neighborliness.
He's
like
maintaining this road that's at the base of our properties. Like, I know. And I'm wondering if he, when I was waving at him, if he knew, like, oh, I'm really screwing this dude over. Like, I'm wondering if in the back of his mind he was like, didn't want to get involved because he was like, I wonder if he was conscious of the fact that as he's clearing his driveway, he is creating a barrier for me getting out of my driveway. Again, one that was easily remedied. I just, it literally took 5 minutes. I shoveled out a path to victory for me so that if and when I do actually try to start my car, which I haven't done for like 3 days now, which is slightly concerning, when I do try to start my car and get out of here, I can do it. It's not like I'm not trapped here by that embankment, but it was funny because I was like, did he consider just going down? I mean, did he consider going down my driveway a little bit in the tractor?
Yeah, that especially if you're the person with the heavier machinery too. This is very curious. It almost seems like you have to... I'm not trying to get in your head more about this, but it almost seems like you have to deliberately kind of acknowledge, like when I'm trimming the hedges that go all the way around our house, and they're kind of tall hedges, as I've described many times, these hedges also go partially around my neighbor's house. Now, there's no expectation for me to do my entire neighbor's hedges. There's too much of them. Nobody expects that. But I have to make a conscious decision about where that line ends.
Yes.
You know what I mean? And so, I act accordingly. I stop where I think it seems like I should stop, but it's never not on my mind. And then we had neighbors in New Hampshire. In fact, like this fella isn't around anymore because he was an older guy and he did pass away several years ago. But our neighbor, David, he would be out there. We had shovels to shovel our driveway, but he had a snow blower and he would often, not always, but quite often come over to our house with his snow blower and do our driveway. And I think there's several reasons for that. Neighborliness. It's very kind of like, that's a very kind of New Hampshire-y neighborly kind of thing to do. Secondly, because he did know that he had the power equipment to do it. Third, because I think there is some joy in doing that, depending on how much. If you have a snowblower but a small driveway, like you want to snowblow other people's driveways too. I would. I think there's some satisfaction in that. Even shoveling, there's some satisfaction in that, although I'm glad I don't have to do it to go to work or whatever. But
yeah, be careful. You have a heart attack.
Yeah, no, because I'll just say, don't have a heart attack. Don't have a heart attack. I'm going to stop eating vegetables, in fact, and just start that mantra. But anyway, so I'm not trying to paint I think I'm blowing this up bigger than it is, but it does seem like a guy who's got the tractor, who's doing the plowing or whatever, and who has probably been doing this for years before you moved in there, like it's not lost on him what he's doing to your driveway. What WTF? Da fook.
It's interesting. I will tell you this. I am very, very confident that if I got stuck here and I called him, he'd be over here in a minute helping
me. Yeah.
Like I think he's a very helpful person. And also I will add, he has a lot of driveway to deal with. Like his property is pretty expansive. And this summer when I was trying to keep him posted on where my progress was with getting, so I down the hill from my house is this big kind of field thing. And I have to get that, as I've talked about on the show extensively, brush hogged every summer, which is I've got to get this guy named Jerry out here to go and basically kind of mow it all down. It's not the kind of thing you could do on any kind of normal mower or even riding mower. You need like an industrial type of deal. And I always try to keep my neighbor Brian posted because he's rightfully so, I think, has concerns about wildfire and things like that. So I was like, you know, this summer I said, hey, I'm on this. I just want you to know I haven't forgotten. I'm just waiting for the guy to come out here. And he's like, yeah. He goes, oh, thanks. You know, cool. He goes, yeah, it's been killing me. He goes, something to the effect of, yeah, it's been killing me just trying to keep my side of things down. So in other words, I think that he puts a lot of work into maintaining his property, and I think It's not like he's out there for yayas. It's like, I think that it's like, you know, he, in other words, he's not just the guy with a snowblower who has like has 20 feet of sidewalk and he's just looking for something else to do with it. I think he sees all of this as like the work associated with maintaining his property. But that being said, it would have been such a nice neighborly thing if I came out and someone had just plowed a little path to my car, like, hey, this is now you can get out of your driveway with this. And if you're on a mechanized machinery, seems like, you know, but anyway.
Or at least clean up, or at least if you're not going to go out of your way to do that, and maybe even if I didn't know my neighbor super well. Although it sounds like you guys are kind of buds. But if I didn't know my neighbor super well, maybe I wouldn't want to be presumptuous and go onto their property, you know. But I mean, if I have created a little bit of a mess doing my work for my yard in front of somebody else's driveway, I definitely think it's my responsibility to clean at least that up, not make my neighbor's life harder.
I think that the part of the problem is I have a sign that says, forget the dog, owner shoots on sight.
Uh-huh.
So he probably didn't want to come onto my property because he knows...
Mm-hmm.
Kind of how seriously I take the sanctity of my castle.
I have one that says, beware of Doug.
That's PETA's new kind of guidance on that is beware of Doug.
You know that? That's an old Far Side joke. Did you know that? And there's just like,
now that you say that, it reminds me.
You're just sort of lurking behind a mailbox, I think. I've been enjoying the Far Side page a day calendar, by the way. You were not around for this, but I don't know.
Did you actually start doing your page? And we could bring that into this program. Lord knows, it'd give us something to talk about.
Well, here's the deal. I while you were out a couple of weeks ago for the holidays, I went kind of far down the road of pursuing my plan of having, I wasn't sure if it should be random listeners or one person every day. I didn't know exactly what the plan was, but I got a newly rebooted 2024 Far Side page a day calendar from my folks. And I was very excited for January 1st so I could rip into this thing. I used to have these in the 90s when I was a youth, and they brought it back for 2024, just using archived cartoons from back in the day, Gary Larson's work from back in the day, not new stuff. And I thought maybe we could have like somebody on the phone line, like if I sent them a photo of the cartoon each day, we could play it on this show.
Maybe I was not against that idea, for the record.
Yeah, no, and it was getting... And
as long as it involved no additional work for me.
And then people started saying, hey, I want to be one of the people to read that. I got like maybe 4 or 5 requests from people. I'm like, okay, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to take a photo. And sorry for folks, I kind of already, I think, told this story a couple of weeks ago when Genevieve was on. But
it's new to me.
Yeah, that's right. If you missed it the first
the
time,
co-host
it's new
of the
to
program.
You.
This is all new information.
I did have to explain this to several people. So I decided to take a photo of the first 5 cartoons. It would be the first broadcast week of TBTL of 2024 and send it to all of these people who requested it. Then once I got the results, I would decide like how to mix it up or whatever. And I want to be clear here. I mean, I know I'm a little bit of a butterfly. I'm not personally offended by any of the cartoons that were in the first 5 days, but I didn't see them fitting well with TBTL. I don't know who compiled this thing. I mean, sure, the Far Side sometimes went into some edgy territory for the 80s or 90s. But like the very first one for January 1st, I think was the Monday, was about literally, Luke, about eating dog. It was like cavemen eating dog. And the joke was something like where the term putting on the dog comes from, which was a phrase I'd never even heard of before. Then there was one about cowboys lynching people.
Whoa.
And then there was one about, and then the other one was about, oh, it was kind of like about blind people like protesting the wrong building. And
oh,
I was just like,
Gary,
3 out of 5, like welcome to 2024, 3 3 out of 5 of these cartoons.
Well, welcome to Biden's woke America, where we can't
yeah,
even
exactly.
enjoy the Far Side
I'm such
anymore.
And again, like, I think that I'm not like burning the calendar in the streets. Like the calendar belongs where it belongs, which is on the little tall boy outside my bathroom so I can tear it off every day and smile a little bit. But I was just like, I don't know if the first 3 out of 5 of these kind of make me pause. I'm like, I like the idea of maybe children reading them. And then I had problems imagining like this weekend there was an electric chair one, which really did make me laugh. But like, I don't know. I was like, you know what?
Is that the old Sparky one?
know this one. I don't remember this one. Now I'm just doing it. Now I'm just doing it anyway. It was kind of funny. It was a classroom full of people and like an adult education class. And on the chalkboard is just a big picture of a switch, like the kind of like stereotypical switch you would see in a, like an electric chair scene in an old movie. And it just says, "No, Todd, quickly flicking it up and down is not the right answer. Does anybody else want to take a guess at how to operate this thing," or something along those lines? And the way it was written was funnier than how I presented it here. But it was, again, one of those things where it's like, I can smile at that in my basement briefly and just be like, oh, that's a little dark, whatever. But just like bringing all of this into TBTL, especially if I was asking listeners to do it, it just was like, I don't know. I don't know how much time we want to spend explaining things or, you know, adding context.
Totally. It raises the question for me of whoever, you know, is syndicating this. Were there, again, I don't want to be like the woke police, but there had to be 365 Far Side cartoons that held up better than, you know, something about eating a dog or something about being, you know, something that's kind of vaguely racist or ableist or whatever. Like, there's got to be enough of them that aren't that you could throw those in. I wonder why they didn't. I wonder why they didn't run it through the, like, because it's already a hard thing to pick because there's so many of them. Picking 365, you're already throwing out some winners. Why not throw out the ones right away that just seem like these might hit people differently in 2024?
I want to be very clear about something, though. When I say lynching, it was like a cowboy lynch mob situation, which is obviously like kind of triggering, but it was not racially motivated in any way. So there was no, I have not seen anything.
It was
in the calendar.
It was Pace Picante get a rope territory.
It was that tone, exactly. But again, like, it's just, that's not necessarily something I need I need to bring in. But there was nothing I'll bet you there is stuff, now that I think about it, that probably pertains to native people that actually doesn't stand the test of time. But so far, I haven't gotten to anything that I would describe as being racially insensitive.
So it sounds like during the time that we had the Winter Games and I was away, the idea finally sort of came to fruition and then was rejected.
Yeah, no,
it lived a whole life cycle.
I took,
like, while I was gone,
I was taking photos of them. And I was like, oh yeah, I'm gonna send these to the folks. And I was like, okay, oh, eating dog. Okay. Well, I'm sure Tuesday's better. Oh well, I'm sure Wednesday's better. Oh, come on, guys, this is what you picked for the first week.
We should thank some donors, but I will tell you that it is hazardous out here. With the snow and everything, and the fact that I did take a tumble the other day. Do you want me to play you? I don't know if this will really pay off, but do you want to play you some audio of me trying to... well, here's what happened. To go between the house and the Madrona Hill studio, which is also where the treadmill is, I have to, like, change my shoes. There's so much snow that I can't wear my running shoes out here because they'll be soaking wet by the time I get... Now that I've shoveled everything, there is a path, but at the time there wasn't any path. So I had to put on some, like, snow boots and then carry my running shoes and then change out here. And I thought that would be kind of a funny video to send to Becca. And so, do you want to hear the sound of me just absolutely eating shit in the snow? So this is me slipping on the snow boots out on my porch. Now I'm taking on the snow, going up the stairs. I'm videotaping this, by the way.
No.
By the way, my phone completely enveloped in snow.
I could tell. I was going to ask you, like, that is not the sound of somebody in pain. That is the sound of somebody who thinks they ruined something valuable.
Yeah, I think I ruined my phone. I realize, and this is the truly... This is the crazy part of the world we now live in, or at least the world that I've constructed for myself out here. I realized I have this whole event from two different camera angles because I also have like a Google Nest cam.
Sure, yeah.
So then I was able to go back and watch the footage. I didn't even think of this. I was able to watch the footage, the omniscient, like, third, whatever you call it, you know, sort of omniscient perspective footage of me falling on the stairs and dropping my phone into the snowdrift and just absolutely mooning the camera, just real strong butt crack sticking out of my running shorts. It's not a good look at all. But I'm like, this is where I'm at out here. I'm just photo and video documenting my entire journey, and it's getting to be a little weird.
Well, at least it didn't sound super painful. Did you have more to play? Wait, I think we interrupted.
No, that was it. That was it.
Yeah.
It.
Well, at least it wasn't like, oh god.
No,
like,
it was. It was not painful, but I thought I had. Right, I thought I had broken my phone, and I was very upset at myself. But I guess what I'm saying is I'm becoming. All, you know, I'm 3 days into this, but because I'm up here, because I can't really go anywhere, or it would be treacherous for me to, I am just kind of cocooning a little bit, but I'm cocooning by myself, so I feel like I'm getting weirder. Like, you know, like, I have all the comfort. My power has been on the whole time. I have enough food. I'm like complete. I'm not in any way unsafe. I mean, there are people that are in like negative 50 degrees right now, mm-hmm. So I don't want to overstate my dilemma, but it is just kind of odd being up here by myself and feeling like I kind of can't go anywhere. Mm-hmm. And like, I don't know. I'm just, I feel kind of snowbound, but in a very comfortable, you know, way where I'm not wanting for anything. Here's what I want. And we're going to talk more about television coming up with this Peacock thing. I want them to start showing television programs earlier on a Sunday night. So I've been reading some reviews of the newest iteration of True Detective, and this one's got Jodie Foster.
I knew you were going to say that. Man, their marketing has really worked. Genevieve came in last night. I'm sorry to totally cut you off, but like, we're living definitely in the same world. Genevieve came in the kitchen yesterday evening while I was making chili, because I'm leaning into it too. And she said, you know, the True Detective marketing is too good. And I'm like, oh, yeah, I kind of want to watch that now too. She said, yeah, but it's not on yet. I got to wait until 9 o'clock. She's like, they've got me refreshing. And I'm just like, it sounds like you have a very similar experience.
Exactly. The football games were done. I was like, well, I thought, oh, I'll watch True Detective and then I can talk to Andrew about it tomorrow. And I go like, I have to, first of all, I had to log into Max, which kicked Becca off of it at her house, because we've been watching that documentary about the woman, Natalia Grace, who was adopted, and there's questions about her actual age, et cetera. So I re-log into the thing here so I can watch True Detective, and I'm all like ready to go. And I don't know how anything works anymore, because I'm like on the, first of all, I guess I don't get HBO on my television anymore. You know what I mean? Like
through your cable subscription.
And maybe, I mean, is there a universe in which I'm paying for Max, but I'm not getting it on my cable package? Can that be?
I mean, there is a way. I know that when we had regular cable, we paid for HBO through our regular cable, but that gave us access to it on any computer as well with a Max login. It wasn't called Max then, but essentially.
Well, that's what I should be doing.
But I don't know what you're doing over there. But I did not know that they had any regulators on there where one person gets kicked off in a different household. We've talked about Netflix clamping down on that.
They apparently do, because Becca texted me last night, I need to know what happens to this kid.
Oh.
And I was like, oh, sorry. Like, because I had recommandeered the Max subscription to try to watch True Detective. So I guess I'm doing it wrong. What I should be doing is just getting stupid HBO through my cable, and then if I need to go on the line and watch it, do that. But anyway, I log into Max through my smart television, and I'm like looking everywhere, and it's like True Detective. So I hit play, and I realize it's the McConaughey season.
Oh, gosh.
And I'm like, oh, okay, this is the wrong one. So I back it out, and then I'm looking around, and then I realize there's a huge banner for the Jodie Foster one, but I can't watch it. And I'm like, what the hell? And I look, and it's like 8:20.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, are you S-ing me? Like, I have to wait until 9 p.m. West Coast for this? And then I just went to sleep. Like, I have not watched it, because 9 p.m. was too late for me to start a television program. That's where I'm at in my maturation process.
Well, if you plan on talking about it on TBTL, maybe I'll try to watch it too today, because that is one that I have some interest in. And so I'd rather watch it before anybody tells me anything about it.
Yeah, maybe let's try to, although tonight is also Iowa caucus night. And I don't really know
it's not tomorrow. Oh, why did I think it was tomorrow? They don't hold it on Tuesdays, huh? I knew it was this week, but I just assumed it was Tuesday.
I think it's today.
Okay.
And I'm pretty sure. And I am, I mean, this is how, as the kids say on TikTok, how delulu I am. This is how delusional I now am. I'm just like, please somehow let the weather sit. I know this isn't going to be the case tonight, but I just want to be watching MSNBC and having Steve Kornacki kind of surprisingly pointing at parts of the big board going, we expected a stronger turnout for Trump here. Mm-hmm. Like, it's not going to happen, but I just want this to somehow be a night where I feel a small sense of, like, I don't know, the world is not, the American political landscape is not as dark as it feels to me. Mm-hmm. And I, so I'm, point is, if it starts
you're
to go in that
Ramaswamy guy, just say it. I mean, it's fine.
I mean, that's the irony here. Who am I hoping is prevailing over
Trump?
Weirdly
Haley. Weirdly Haley.
Probably Nikki Haley.
We can't get into this, but weirdly
it's
Haley.
Nikki, I mean, you know, it's like, it's just, I mean, I just want anything that, I want anything that makes Donald Trump feel sad tonight.
Yeah, right.
So whatever that is. But, and I mean, I, you know, not, I'm not to get into the politics of this or the X's and O's of it, but unfortunately, it wouldn't, I don't think it statistically really matters who wins Iowa or New Hampshire. I heard that, like, there are a good number of early primaries that could be won by, say, Nikki Haley or DeSantis or whatever, which is completely not feasible, but let's just say they do. And it still wouldn't really shake Trump's grip on the party or on getting nominated as the, like, just the way that the math of the whole thing is. I would like it if at least he can't declare victory tonight. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Because I think that just makes his life harder. And, you know, the more that things are slightly still up for debate while his legal troubles are churning on, the better it is, I think, you know. Although, again, I don't know, why am I doing this here on a Monday episode of the show? But, like, I mean, the irony is I think Nikki Haley probably beats Joe Biden pretty handily.
Yeah.
You know, like,
yeah, that's true.
Trump is the least electable candidate they have, and yet I don't want him to be the nominee because he terrifies me.
Yeah.
But, like, If you look at how anyone other than Trump does against Biden, I mean, I don't know if they've gotten down to the lowest tiers of the candidates, but, like, if you definitely look at, like, probably DeSantis and Nikki Haley, my guess would be that they trounce Biden on paper. The only person who's less popular than Biden appears to be Donald Trump. So it's like, nominate him at your peril. But it still just scares me. You know
yeah,
what I mean? It's
you have
weird.
No,
it's like,
idea what happens during a general election. Like, anything could
yes.
happen.
Right. Anything could happen, although I think that actually the chances are better for a Republican candidate who's not named Donald Trump. People don't get up in the morning fearing the existence of Nikki Haley the way that I fear the existence mm-hmm. or I fear the future of a Donald Trump presidency. Like mm-hmm. that feels like an existential threat to democracy. Nikki Haley just seems like a person with bad takes. But, you know, I do think it's the general political wisdom that Trump is the weakest general candidate they have, and yet he's going to get the nomination, which is just very bizarre to think about.
I wonder if there are people in our audience right now who are like, you know what, go back to sports. At least that doesn't put
stay
a
in your
in
lane.
And I don't
go
even,
back to talking about
mean,
not watching True Detective.
And by the way, I don't even mean that in like that you and I are out of our depths here or anything. I haven't said much, and you are not out of your depth. But I just mean it in, like, as we have this conversation, I feel my own stomach kind of constricting, and not in the good, like, tight body kind of way, but more mm-hmm. like the pit in my stomach, and just sort of like it's just been. You know, it's been seeping in more and more as we get closer and closer to the caucuses. And, you know, and I'm sure you have heard this a million times, too. I think I heard the other day that, like, no Republican has won Iowa and then gone on to the to win the presidency in, like, I think three caucus cycles or something
oh, interesting.
Like that. So it's, you know, it's today doesn't mean.
No, I mean, I think
in that
like,
way,
didn't
but just
Rick Santorum win it 1 year. I mean, I think that
yeah,
there's a,
I think Santorum
there's a history of it kind of generating non-sustainable results.
Yeah, I think Huckabee won it. Mm-hmm. Anyway, it doesn't matter. And now I am out of my depths. But my point was not just that, like, I for me personally, you know, I'm not saying that I don't follow national, international, and political news, you know.
What
over
about
the...
Interstellar?
That I don't. I don't watch Star Trek. Anyway, I follow things. I'm not in lockstep with everything the Biden administration does, whatever. But, like, the existential, I don't even know, not even dread, but just the existential situation that we woke up to every single morning under the Trump presidency and the pre-Trump presidency, and that feeling, the icy fingers of that feeling are starting to grip me a little bit as things yeah. get real again and we have to actually yeah. confront this again. And so yeah. that's why I made that joke. Just I wonder how many people are like hate us talking about sports, but at least it doesn't give them the bad feeling.
Hey
Hey, let's thank some of our donors who are making today's edition of TBTL possible with a generous monthly contribution, or maybe a one-time yearly contribution. I don't know the exact breakdown of how the resources came into the TBTB coffers, but they're coming in, and it's allowing this to be our job. We do 5 days a week. I don't want to throw any shade at other podcasts that I really like 99% Invisible. Andrew, it's been 100% Invisible lately. All right. No, I keep refreshing the feed, and it keeps being like best, not even just best of, but like, you know, a re-airing, which, hey, no shame in that game. But then also, like, it's been a while since a re-airing, and I'm just like, you know, me and Andrew, we get in here 5 days a week, and we do the work. It's all about preparation.
Mm-hmm. And we have we have similar workloads, I think.
Absolutely. We're studying the film.
Mm-hmm.
We're ready.
We've storyboarded everything that we're talking about here
absolutely.
Today.
Mm-hmm. So anyway, here we are doing the show here on remembrance of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Day. Here we are. We're doing a show for you because of folks who are supporting us, like Don Melnick, who's in Highlands, New Jersey. Greeting, Highlands, New Jersey.
What does Highlander say?
Highlander says,
never die twice.
Oh, really?
No. It's
is that
even
Sean
close
Connery
that.
Or Christopher Lambert?
Oh, that's right, because there was a movie and a TV show, right?
Oh, I didn't. Yeah. I'm honestly, like, I never really watched the Highlander series, but I do think our friend Camaro Kev could give you some chapter and verse on that.
What's the main boy? I know we have listeners who are going bananas here. There can only be one? No, that's Lay's potato chips. Wait. I feel like Highlander has a very, very famous expression that
what
is like
the
their
famous,
log line.
It is better to burn out than to fade away.
I'm getting that too, but that's not the one that I'm thinking of. There can only be one is the tagline from the 1986 film Highlander. There can only be one.
Why did the Kurgan's eyes turn black, Andrew?
Okay, so this is a
why
riddle.
Do birds suddenly appear every time you are near?
Oh,
just why can
like
there
me,
people all
they
people
long
also ask why
me.
Can there only be one Highlander?
This is what other people are asking.
Yeah, people also ask, why can there be only one Highlander? Fair question.
Yeah, no, that is true.
Why can there only be one?
Copyright law. The answer is
what if there were
law.
Two Highlanders? I mean, what is the world going to implode? Peter Williams and I used to always say, I think when the Highlander film came, is Sean Connery in the Highlander film?
I'm not sure. You threw that out there, and I'm double checking it here.
There's some kind of a scene that in the film version, and my memory is that it involves Sean Connery saying "Greetings, Highlander."
Okay.
To, I guess the Highlander or whatever.
He's listed here. He's listed as a cast member.
And he says,
of Highlander.
Like, you know, in his very sort of Scottish brogue, if you will, in his Sean Connery way, "Greetings, Highlander." And that's a terrible Sean Connery impression. But I just remember that Peter Williams and I, it must have been in the trailer or something. Peter Williams and I used to say "Greetings, Highlander" to each other. Like 3 times a week from age 12 to 17. We just say greetings, Highlander, all the time. I've never even seen the movies or the TV shows.
Let me ask you this. This is very much a sidebar issue, but
yeah.
Who do you think makes the decision? What photo is used for your IMDb page if you're an actor? Because I'm noticing that Sean Connery's profile pic on IMDb is like an old black and white. I mean, he's a handsome man. He's always been a handsome man, obviously. It's been noted. But this one, he's like probably in his, I don't know, late 20s, early 30s or something. Maybe older than that. I don't know. People back then always, I think, gave off an older presence. But then sometimes you look up an actor and it's like their most recent thing. And you're like, really? Mm-hmm. I mean, nothing wrong with aging, but sometimes it's kind of unflattering and more recent. It's like, well, that's not what I think of. Like when you think of somebody's like kind of glory days as an actor and then you see them, what they look like today, but they only did one voice in Rango 2. Is that your joke? I'm trying to.
Yeah, that is
my
joke.
It Rango? Yeah, okay.
It's I believe they only made one. I think it's Rango.
Rango. More on Horse Commander 3 later on in the show, too,
by the way.
Yeah, we'll get to that in the email.
Promises made, promises kept.
Yeah, but anyway, I'm just wondering, like, is it publicists? Is it just somebody at IMDb? Who gets to make these decisions?
That's a great question. I mean, Sean Connery, boy, he had a long career. Because if you scroll down a little bit, so you're right, I've never seen a photo of him as young as the main photo. It doesn't even say Sean Connery to me. Yeah. It's like young, handsome actor of the 1950s.
Yeah, giving a steely kind of, gaze.
Which is kind of what, you know, but it's not how I think of him. Maybe it's just an age thing. I don't even think of Sean Connery as James Bond. That'd be people maybe a bit older than me. I think of him as the guy in The Untouchables.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, right. He played a Bobby, right?
Yeah, or like,
or a Russian sub commander.
Seriously.
Naturally, yeah.
Those are that's the era of Sean Connery that I think of. And so you're right to see this, like, 1950s version where I presume he was also in a local band in Glasgow. You know what I mean? Like, he was also, you know, in the, I don't know what the band was called, the Black Diamonds, and they were like a 4-person quartet. Like, I feel like all of these famous people, you know, who became famous, like, they were all trying a lot of shit when they were younger, probably trying to make it. And, you know, like, this version of Sean Connery, this young, hungry, I'm just trying to, you know, make it in entertainment, is not the version of Sean Connery that I think of.
I feel like the band would be the Something Men. Like,
yes,
the
you're absolutely
the Liveryman,
right.
You also
had more time to think about it.
No, that's definitely true. Yeah, no, I'm just not
a
contest.
But you are so right. You're 100%. No, I'm verifying, or what's under protest? What is it like when, what happened in the NFL a few years ago? I think we're like, a coach like said, like, I'm conceding the game, but under protest, or I'm signing off on the game, but under protest.
Or something. I don't remember.
I'm signing off on that reference because it was way better, but under protest.
Okay, gotcha.
You had more time to think of it. Amanda Triggs is in Cedro Woolley, Washington. The Wolves. Love that place. Thank you, Amanda,
for supporting
the program. Jessica Shard is in Portage, Michigan.
Oh, bet you it's cold there.
Oh, man, I know. Oh, I can't even imagine. Thank you, Jessica, for supporting the program. I'm glad also I've been thinking a lot about... not a lot, but I've been reflecting somewhat on the fact that the University of Washington football team is undergoing a period of rapid change, Andrew. Mm-hmm. And I'm kind of proud of myself that the day after the national championship, I think I handled it with a certain amount of I was respectful towards the fact that Michigan won. I wasn't happy about it, but I also didn't. I didn't get personal. I didn't get ugly, and I'm glad because we have a lot of listeners in Michigan. And I've
you
been
mean you
like,
didn't you didn't refer to their coaches as a pinch-faced bastard or whatever?
No.
Whatever I called. I'm proud that I didn't take it personally either, and
exactly.
I didn't even go to school there.
Amanda has footnoted. excuse me, Jessica has footnoted her donation. This is only going to Luke's salary.
Fair enough.
No, but I've been thinking honestly. Like, this happens a lot because we. I'll talk for myself here. I'm very caught up in sports, and whenever the team I'm rooting for is playing another team, there is a large number of people that are rooting for that other team who also donate
sure.
to the show.
Yeah, of course.
And it makes me think, oh, I gotta just make sure that I don't unduly. It would really, really be a bummer if I was alienating what few listeners we have over something as meaningless as sports.
Yeah, and as I was saying to you before the show, we won't get into the details because we specifically had our sports talk off the air today, so we wouldn't bring it up here. But, like, generally speaking, my own fandom has evolved in weird ways that I wouldn't have expected, so that I'm, you know, here I am in 2024 actively rooting for the Baltimore Ravens, a team that I had so many personal, I mean, ridiculously personal animosity towards, you know what I mean? And so you never know what your journey is going to be. There could be a day where you and I, Luke, are in the stands in sub-zero weather in half blue and half yellow body paint.
Yep. Yes, I look forward to that day. Mm-hmm. As does Chris Murray, who's in Kingston, Ontario, Canada.
Now, that's interesting. Thank you, Chris. Also, that means we have at least two listeners in Kingston, Ontario, right?
Because do we have, is our listener Bill?
I think Bill moved over
formerly
there,
Bill of Toronto.
Yeah.
I wonder if Bill helped tell Chris about the show or vice versa, or if they
maybe.
Know each other.
Yeah, maybe. Or Chris heard that Bill moved there, so Chris moved there too.
Uh-huh, sure. That's happening a lot these days.
Yep.
Thank you, Chris. Thanks also to good old Gether Kenyon.
Gether.
Together again. Here we are. How many years in a row have we had Gether in there?
I know. And so it started as a typo, right? Gether,
yes.
Like what, 7-8 years ago? And now your wife's new name is Gether. Gether.
Gether.
Like it's just
Gether.
Your legal name is now Gether Kenyon.
That's right. Thank you, Gether, for supporting the program all these years and allowing us to now intentionally misstate your name. Thank you, Heather, a.k.a. Gather. Thanks also to Margaret Kearney, who's in Whitefish, Montana. I bet you there's no snow in Whitefish, Montana.
No, it's probably pretty balmy there.
It's probably about like 70 or 80, potentially. Margaret, I hope you're doing all right out there. That's the other thing, too, Andrew, is I'm going on and on about my little adventures here of needing to shovel some amount of snow. But, like, compared to what is happening in places in the United States right now, I got nothing to complain about. Like, I can only imagine Whitefish, Montana, and our listeners out in upstate New York and in the Midwest and pretty much just about everywhere, maybe north of Palm Beach, is dealing with weather stuff. So hope everybody's doing okay out there. Thank you to our donors today for making TBTL happen.
Hello and welcome to Top Story.
So NBC says that 23 million people streamed the football game this weekend. The game between the Kansas City Chiefs and the Miami Dolphins streamed it on Peacock. And that is, they say, a record in the U.S., which I thought was an interesting distinction. Like, was there something not in the U.S. that's been streamed more? I noticed this was the buildup of this was happening last week as I was watching lots and lots of football, and NBC kept promoting the fact that history was going to be made this weekend because this particular playoff game was only going to be available on streaming if you didn't live in one of the two cities where the teams were from. And I thought, boy, that's a real, that's an interesting play here. They kept saying, look, you know, watch history be made on, you know, Saturday or whatever. And I was like, that is a really, really interesting framing device for this. That's like if, you know, you've paid for your car and you have no payment on it, and then the dealership calls you and goes, watch history be made when we charge you for the car again. Like, that would be historic. Is it good? No, but it would be something that's unprecedented. Like, they were, it was as if this was, it was just a really weird way to talk about it to me. People started noting it last week. They're like, what is with NBC trying to pretend like this is a historic event we're excited about? They've historically figured out a way to get us to pay extra money for something by withholding it from us. But, like, the framing of that is just so odd to me.
That's really interesting because I've heard some people talking about the Peacock thing. Of course, I didn't watch the game that was on Peacock, so it doesn't matter, but I also just sort of bootleg all of the games now anyway. In fact, I was going to tell you.
You're a freedom fighter, essentially, on this one.
I did watch last night's game, the Lions game, and whatever feed I was watching went down, or my computer didn't react well to it after a while, so I had to switch to a different feed, and it took me a second to realize all the commercials were Australian. I ended up watching a U.S. football match, a U.S.
Love
football
it.
Game, via an Australian feed. So it was all these like ESPN Australia commercials and like Get in the Ring stuff. That's what I call like the punch fighting, whatever you call that stuff. But anyway,
Australia is a wonderful island.
So yeah, but I heard people saying like, are you going to sign up for this game so you can, or for Peacock so you can watch this, and then will you cancel it right away, or you can get a free trial but you have to give them your credit card? So like, how many people will remember to unsubscribe afterwards?
Me.
Yeah, so you
I
did.
Actually have today's show pick if you want. It's a screen grab of me canceling my Peacock account and me writing in the comment section why I'm canceling.
Oh, okay. Ooh, sounds like you gave him what for.
I think I wrote, it's on my other computers in the house, so I'll send it to you after the show. I think I said something like, you extorted us into buying your service to watch the game, you monsters. I don't think that's going to I don't think a human's ever going to see it.
Yeah.
And to be honest with you, I go back and forth on this whole thing, like how actually mad I am. I mean, I was annoyed at it, annoyed by it, but also it was like, I don't know, like there's a lot of things that cost money. Why? How is this like a sacred? I guess the reason that it's frustrating is because if you're me anyway, I'm also paying a bunch of money every month for like my cable service to watch these kinds of things. I saw somebody going, why is everyone mad? You already have to have Amazon to watch the Thursday night game. Which is kind of true. I guess because I have Amazon, I don't have to go sign up for a new thing. That one doesn't hit me as that's not as frustrating to me. And
this
know,
is a playoff game, so it sort of seems like a national thing. Like, if it's a Thursday night football game and it's like Jags Chargers, and you know, in November or whatever, it's like whatever. I don't care that I'm missing. You might, you know, I like Thursday night football, but no, that did kind of bother me. But now you have like these are all national games now. They're all playoff games, and so that was like I think this is the first paywalled playoff game, I'm guessing.
I believe so. And yeah. This, I mean,
they made
this
history.
This was Mike. History was made, Andrew. Uh-huh. This was Mike Tirico. This was the thing that was also getting a lot of grief on Sunday because, you know, as they were getting into their Sunday games, they then took a moment to celebrate how many of us they made sign up on Saturday for
City, but what a scene last night as the Chiefs began defending their Super Bowl title with a 26-7 win over Miami, a night memorable for many reasons. So many unforgettable images from the fourth coldest playoff game in NFL history, and the passion of NFL fans added to the record books. An average of 23 million people streamed the game on Peacock, making the first ever NFL playoff game to be exclusively streamed, the most streamed event of any kind in the U.S. ever. Super Wildcard Saturday was also an all-time record day for U.S. internet traffic, with most of those people interacting with NFL content online.
Oh,
congratulations to our Comcast and
so
NBC
boring.
Universal teammates, and thanks to Commissioner Roger Goodell and our partners at the NFL. And all.
By the way, that's a weird. I don't understand enough about how all of the, you know, tentacles of this corporation work. But why are they thanking, or why are they nodding to the Comcast people? That sounds to me. Like, isn't Comcast, isn't that who I'm paying money to? Isn't that Xfinity? Isn't that who I'm paying money to have this on my goddamn cable?
If I answer that, I'm going to get a lot wrong. But Comcast, wasn't Comcast under the same corporate overlord as NBC? NBC Universal Comcast? No? I'm not sure. But either way, like, that whole thing, I'm just struck by, like, I know that the NFL does all kinds of like promos or whatever, but like, I don't know. I can't remember ever just hearing them read such a long, dry press release that must have been just like part of the deal and like thanking Goodell and all. Like, what what terrible programming is that? God, talk about just like sniffing your own corporate farts.
But like, really trying to convince us all that somehow, we were part of history and part of some sort of like, we did it.
Yeah.
America, we banded together and we repelled the Ruskies. Oh, wait, I'm sorry. We just all paid $5 for something that we had to pay $5 for if we wanted to watch, you know, this game without having to go through a sort of extra legal means. Like, I just the idea that somebody at the NBC kind of marketing level was like, here's how we're going to talk about. I mean, it was a very consistent messaging, which was, we're not going to get it. We're not going to pretend like this is not happening. And we're also not going to soft pedal it. And we're not going to apologize. We're going to try to reframe this as like a national celebration of a streaming record and just not mention the fact that everyone doing it who didn't have Peacock had to sign up for it. I'd be really curious to see what the cancellation data looks like today. I canceled my account, even though I signed up. It was $5.99. I had to do it for a month. I still have the account for a month. I could have waited till the month was over. I was like, I'm canceling this today to kind of send a message to them, a very, very small message. And also because I know that I will forget 29 days from now. And then I will just get that update on my phone that just says, you just re-upped your Peacock subscription and I'm going to be mad. So I was like, I'm just going to cancel this right now, even if it does cost me some part of this month that I'm entitled to, which I guess it actually doesn't.
I would guess not. Like, if you paid for a month and then canceled, I was going to ask you that, but you still do have it until the end of that first month that you paid for, right?
Yeah, I do. But I will tell you this. I mean, this is just the beginning, would be my guess. Like, I have a feeling that next season it's going to happen more and more, and we're just going to be, you know, buying these games a la carte or from so many different sources. And I guess if the price of my cable TV goes down, I guess I don't care that much because it's like, I'm paying this money. I want to get this content. Either I pay it all to Xfinity or I pay less to Xfinity and a little bit more to other people. And I just cobble it together. But it just feels like we're going in a direction where I'm going to have to be subscribing to 20 different things if I want to get all of this kind of content easily available to me.
And Peacock is the one streaming service that we don't pay for in our house that it has the biggest impact on me, if that makes sense. The only thing, there are other streaming services out there, I'm sure, that we don't pay for. We pay for the biggies. But like Peacock has had a lot of programming that I'm like, ugh, I would watch that. Now, some of them you can find through, like you say, sort of like extra legal means. But like the Monday Night Football has been on Peacock. And as somebody who doesn't have cable subscription, like the whole season, I think Monday Night Football was on Peacock. That was tempting. Our friend Kat Solon directed a full length comedy special with Chris Fleming. And I still haven't seen that because that was on Peacock. And I hope Kat doesn't hear that. Kat, the parts I've seen are amazing. Some of it went viral on TikTok. I love it so much.
I actually have seen a lot of it on TikTok.
We can't pass a Kumon sign anymore without laughing thinking about that special. Anyway, and also the monk.
Wait, is the joke that I've always been making, which is that the Kumon drawing doesn't look like the kid has it together?
No, that's not the joke, but I know you know the Chris Fleming joke because you and I were both tittering at it over the clip that went viral of Chris Fleming doing the song Parents with Floppy Hats. I'm ruining it, and Kat will probably hear this.
Wide brim hats.
Wide brim hat parents, and they're like negotiating with their monster of a child, and they say, do you want to go to Kumon? Which,
that's funny.
Yeah, because so that's the joke.
I've always just said that I feel like the Kumon drawing... You know, there's like a logo. Yeah. It's like the Kumon drawing looks very confused, is the opposite really of why you're taking your kid to Kumon.
Yeah, that is sort of a good point. Do you remember the Simpsons joke where they're like, Bart's been drawing some dark images or whatever, and he's like, oh, that looks good, like Homer, but Homer doesn't really pay any attention to it and really actually looks at Bart's drawing. He says, ah, send it back to hell. That's a little bit like the Kumon drawing. Ah, send it back to school. And I just was going to say, the Monk, Genevieve and I are fans of the TV show Monk, and they just like created a long Monk episode. I guess they're calling it the Monk movie, but I think of it as a long Monk episode since it was made for TV. But so I got to say, Peacock is the one thing we don't have in our house that it sort of seems like, you know, there's more and more programming there that I want, but I am just a bit of a holdout on it. I'm just like, I don't know, man. I just don't want to. Eventually, I'll probably pay for it, but I'm a holdout. I feel like they've... What I should do, and this might make me feel better, putting the sports stuff aside, because I do think there's something bad on the baseball side of things where they're stripping local broadcasts of local Mariners or baseball games so that you have to subscribe to Apple to watch it. Like, we don't subscribe to Apple or Disney either, but that there's not much compelling there for me. But I think it's real bullshit to have taxpayers who, like, you know, their money does go towards the stadium and picks up some of the bills for these rich teams like the Mariners, but then you literally can't watch it over the air because you have to subscribe to Apple. Like, that is much more insidious to me than not being able to watch a national football game that is out of market. But leaving that stuff aside, like, I probably should just tally up everything that we pay for our streaming services and compare it to what we used to pay monthly for cable. And I'll bet you cutting the cord has still been financially beneficial for us, and adding Peacock would still probably keep us under whatever we were paying for cable, because we were paying out the nose for cable, but it was bundled with our, you know, internet and everything.
See, the problem for me is that I'm just such a creature of habit that all I want to do, like, so, you know, tonight I will be making some dinner and I will turn on MSNBC and I will put on, like, I will go turn the TV on. I will hit a guide and I will, there's a helicopter flying over.
What's going on with you over there?
Can you hear that?
No, I couldn't hear that. I could just hear that something, I wasn't sure if you were messing with your TV or something, caught your eye.
No. There's a helicopter that's flying, like, I don't know, 100 feet over the house and the neighborhood. And for a moment, I was like, is that FedEx? Because I keep getting these updates, FedEx is... I was supposed to have a bunch of appliances delivered over the weekend. And as of Saturday morning, they were like, we're bringing them out. And I was like, there's no way these are getting here. And sure enough, you know, halfway through the day, they're like, sorry, we're actually not going to be delivering those. And then I got another thing from FedEx this morning. We're coming on out. And I was like, yeah, I'll believe it when I see it. Mm. And then, like, as we started the show, I got another update. No, we're actually not doing that today. And then amidst all that, there was just like this weird rumbling noise that I was like, is that a truck? So what you heard was me turning around, looking out the window of the Madrona Hill studio to see if a truck was rumbling down my snow-covered road.
I see.
And realizing, no, in fact, it's, oh, you know what it is, Andrew? It's three military helicopters.
Oh.
That's why it was extra loud. It was three, like, Tomahawk Blackhawks. Mm-hmm. But these are Blackhawks up.
Yeah,
they're up in the sky. And they're show title, Blackhawks Up? Maybe. I don't know. Anyway, they're flying over my house. That's why I got distracted. But what I was going to say is, tonight, I will turn on my TV and I will go to live television. I will watch the channel that I like to watch, MSNBC. Hopefully, our good friend Chris Hayes will be getting lots of airtime. And like, I like doing that. I don't like... Wow, there was my inner Sean Connery. I do not like having to jump around between apps, some of which may be loading, some of which may not be, trying to figure out which thing is going to give me the live sports or the live whatever. Like, I am such a creature of habit. I like to have a television that has channels on it that are sending live things down the line to me at all times, and I can watch them. And even last night, I found myself watching the local Portland news on, like, K2, which I never do, but they're covering all the weather stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And you have, like, trees that are down, and they have some guy, actually I don't remember if this was K2 or one of the other ones, Coin, they've got a dude who just rides around in a car all day and does reports, and he's not driving, somebody else is driving, but he's just like on the road and they're live streaming from the road. It was kind of cool, actually.
I'd like to point out that Traffic Jam Jimmy did all of his own driving
and fish sandwich buying.
Exactly.
I like live television that is, and again, this is just because I'm used to it. I like turning on a television and flipping through the channels. I do, so much more than drawing from one of 900 different sources on my smart television, you know. And even like last night on Max, that was annoying to me because you know what used to happen in the days when I used to watch The Sopranos? I would turn on the TV, I would turn on the cable guide. I had all the HBO shit, so I could watch the East Coast feed of The mm-hmm. Sopranos if I wanted. Because you had HBO West, you had HBO East.
Mm-hmm.
So you'd be like, oh, what's happening on the HBO East feed? It's just obviously the same stuff, but 3 hours ahead. I just like that, and I know that makes me a Luddite. Although, by the way, Luddite gets a really bad, it's kind of a bad rep. The story of the Luddites is very interesting. Are you familiar with it?
No. Is that biblical?
No. It has to do with kind of industrialized UK. And I think that what happened was there was, when the invention of the loom happened, the kind of commercial loom.
Yeah, that's when it all went south.
So textile, because before that, the story goes that people, like basically textile workers were people that were just working from home and making, you know, fabrics and stuff. And you could basically be a weaver or somebody who just did this stuff at home. And then eventually they invented these large looms and they put them in buildings and they wanted the people to come in. It's seriously like the conversation we're having today
mm-hmm.
about work from home versus going into a centralized place. And there was a lot of like pushback against these big industrialized versions of it because the pay was worse and people had to go in and it was unsafe. And so there was this, I think maybe even apocryphal kid whose, I forget, his name was like Lud. And he had, I believe, supposedly been injured in an industrial accident, or he had stood up to someone. There was this kid character who became kind of this folk hero. And the people who sort of celebrated this folk hero and who were pushing back against industrialized stuff were called Luddites.
And so it's a labor thing. It's almost like almost like AI, almost, like, to make it a modern comparison. No, because this is more about, like, it's not about taking jobs away, but it was more about making jobs more dangerous. Or am I misunderstanding that?
It was in the 19th century, English hand craftsmen who rioted for the destruction of the textile machinery that was displacing them. I'm trying to figure out who this.
It was displacing jobs. Okay.
Because of the fact that, like, instead of a bunch of people being able to work from home on this and make different parts of these textiles, they were like, just, they only needed a few of them to run these big giant looms. But really what I want to find out is what the name Oh, Ned Ludd, a young apprentice who was rumored to have wrecked a textile apparatus in 1779. Wow. So he was like, Ned Ludd was this guy who supposedly came in and just destroyed a textile place. And then his followers, they called themselves. There's no evidence Ludd actually existed, like Robin Hood. He was said to reside in Sherwood Forest, but he eventually became the mythical leader of the movement. All that is to say, I know it makes me a Luddite, and I use that in the best way, but I just want to be able to turn on my dang television and go to my dang channel, and I feel like that is going to become harder and harder or more and more expensive for me in the coming years, and I don't like it.
You know what I say? All Eli Whitneys are bastards.
See, I can get one Eli. Is he the cotton gin?
I think he's a cotton gin, a.k.a. interchangeable parts. I don't know if that really has anything to do with the Luddites. I just wanted to drop something in there.
But listen to the thing. The cotton gin didn't make gin, right? It was also like a weaving thing.
Yeah,
or something.
Yeah, I think it.
I always found the word gin being associated with it very confusing.
Yeah, why is it called the cotton gin? That's a good point. I don't even know. I just always took it on faith.
Here I go once again with the email. Every week, I hope that it's from a female. Oh, man, it's not from a female.
All right, email or female before we get out of here.
Yeah, I wanted to mention a couple of things. First of all, I saw this right as I think we were getting ready to roll on the show today. This is just a small little thing I thought was interesting. The music for my weekend on Friday was by a musician called Linda Rich that I stumbled on in a record store, and somebody pointed out that it's ironic that that would be my music for your weekend, considering that that is the name of your made-up neighbors from a previous house, Linda and Rich.
I didn't even put that together.
I don't remember who posted that, but kudos there.
If you have a music for your weekend this weekend from Brian and Bob, something's up.
Right. And Gay, right? Don't you have a neighbor named Gay?
You can't say that anymore, Andrew.
According to Gay. So anyway, I just wanted to point that out. Kudos to the person who pointed that out. Also, I mentioned earlier that we're going to get into this Horse Commander 3 situation, and I'll explain this. So during the daily thank yous to our donors a couple of days ago, we thanked somebody named Andy, and I don't know how we got on the topic, but I said, I'm going to tell you about Horse Commander 3 one of these days, a new video game I'm playing. And Andy wrote in to say, thanks for your donor shout-out on Friday. Luke said I demanded to know what Horse Commander 3 is in his segue, and it didn't very much make me curious about it, but the topic was never returned to. Imagine that. So Andy wants to know
what's going on.
Okay, yeah, you don't need to be so smart.
You know who's not doing a show today? 99% Invisible.
Thanks for your support again, Andy. So here's the deal. I don't know if this is really going to translate into anything interesting, but it's something you can potentially tease me about. But, you know, we were talking about Grand Theft Auto the other day, and they released their big trailer for the big release that'll come out later this year for the latest installment of Grand Theft Auto. And, you know, people who even just casually have heard that but know nothing about gaming probably just think of Grand Theft Auto as like the game that's been sort of notorious for the violence and sort of ickiness of it, which is all real, but it's also like this open world game, which is what really kind of caught our fancy, as we talked about on the show, that like you can just get in a car and yes, you can probably rob banks and 7-Elevens and what have you, but also just like the verisimilitude of the cities that it's based on, in this case Miami, and the ability just to like kind of go off the grid and do your own thing in this open world. That's something that's always appealed to me in video games, even though I don't play a lot of video games. You know, relative to you, I play a lot of video games. Relative to most people who have a video game unit, I don't. I'll play like a football game or a soccer game or whatever. But there is this other game that's made by the same people as Grand Theft Auto, and essentially it's the same kind of deal. In fact, it's very similar sort of in its gameplay, but it takes place out in the Old West. And a lot of people have heard of this. I'm sure
is it Red Dead Redemption?
Exactly. Red Dead Redemption 2. It came out, I'm going to say...
Oh, like Rango 2.
Quite a bit ago now. I'm going to say like maybe even 5 years. And it was a phenomenon when it came out. And I've been hearing about it forever. And it's one of those games that's like, it was like $60 or $70 to buy. And I never trusted myself to buy it because whenever I buy any game that is anything other than me swinging a bat or throwing a football pass, like I end up spending the money and then regretting not playing it more. I'm not into that kind of gameplay that much. But, man, I feel like every now and then you'll just hear another person say, oh, man, Red Dead Redemption 2. You can go out. out and you can ride your horse around and just go hunting and set up camp. And I'm just like, that sounds so great.
The characters did look pretty badass. I remember that guy with the wide brim hat.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
To take it back to wide brim hat talk.
Sure. Yeah. Right. And so I've been sort of keeping an eye on it. And one of the podcasts I listened to had somebody who was reminiscing about how obsessed he was with it for a while. And it had been on my brain. And then with all the talk of Grand Theft Auto, it's been on my brain. And then I don't know if this is a coincidence or not, but sometime around the holidays, I noticed that the price dropped from $70 or $60 to under $20. Like, I don't know if it's because they're like moving on to the new Grand Theft Auto, and so that, you know, drops the price of this. But I was like, $19.99, I will take a flyer on Red Dead Redemption 2, the game that I've been envious of for years now. And so I started playing it around the holidays, and it's really sucked me in. I'm still playing it, and I'm even following the storyline. I'm like 30% through the storyline. I've never played a game where I follow a storyline like this, but it's sticky. It's really got me. When I'm sick of the storyline, I just go out and I hunt antelope, Luke, and it's very relaxing. You do have to skin them, which is a little graphic.
Oof, good.
Yeah, not for you.
As long as you're willing to eat the antelope,
you have to. Yeah, exactly.
You know,
yeah,
the fact that you know where your antelope is coming from.
You actually do need it, like, because then if you find yourself in a gunfight later and you're losing stamina, you need a quick snack. That's one of the funniest parts of the game. You'll be in like one of the bloodiest shootouts and you're just like, hold on, I need a can of corn, just like in the middle of this, just to get your health up.
And then do you like go, does the character then, do you see them eat the can of corn or start munching on antelope, or is it just kind of puts it into your character's system?
I think it pauses for like 15 seconds, like you maybe stop shooting and you hear sort of a chewing sound or something.
Okay.
But then there are other parts. I mean, the graphics, you know, there are parts where the storytelling takes over and you don't really control the characters, and it's very cinematic. I've been very pleased with the experience. In fact, my dark game is probably slipping a little bit because of it. I'm trying to balance it all. I'm trying to have it all, Luke.
Darkbot doesn't have a father figure anymore.
No, here's the deal. I went out for a pack of Red Dead Redemption 2s.
Yeah, exactly.
And I never came back. Now, here's the deal. I find the name Red Dead Redemption 2 cumbersome and not even really a good name for describing what's going on in the movie. And I feel like, in the game, and I feel like a lot of people who play this game have their own little nickname for it. Like, I think some people call it like Magic Horse or whatever. A podcast that Genevieve listens to, I think they call it their Magic Horse game or something. But okay, so I've told you all of that context. Now let's switch gears here. I'm going to bring these two storylines together. But there's also a radio commercial that's been playing on the AM sports station I listen to constantly. And this commercial is in heavy rotation. And I believe it's for Comcast high-speed internet. And the commercial is told from the point of view of a young teenage girl or like a tween or whatever. And she does a really good job in the commercial. And she's like speaking to us, the audience. And she says, boy, I feel bad for the Johnson kids next door. Their parents have slow internet. And so they can, you know, they can barely game. Todd can only play two rounds of Horse Commander 3 before the internet goes out. And I know for a fact that Horse Commander 3 is a stand-in. It's got to be, right? Like, that has got to be that commercial acknowledging Red Dead Redemption 2, Horse Commander 3. Now, you don't play rounds in Red Dead Redemption 2, but, like, Horse Commander 3 has to be a nod towards Red Dead Redemption, right?
I'm just Googling Horse Commander 3, and there's a whiskey that seems to be Horse Commander 3.
I don't think it's a real thing.
No, there's a Horse Soldier Commander Select 3 mm-hmm. bourbon.
Mm-hmm.
That's about all I can find. No, there's definitely not a real thing that I can tell called Horse Commander.
Yeah, so it's definitely like, I'm pretty sure that, again, the story is told from like this teenage girl talking about the teenage boy or tween next door or whatever, saying that he can't play as Horse Commander 3. And I'm like, I know that's Red Dead Redemption. And so that is why I referred to Horse Commander 3 the other day, and that game will forever be known to me as Horse Commander 3. I will tell Genevieve, I'm going downstairs to play Horse Commander 3 for a while.
But wait a second, I'm going to do something. I have my stopwatch ready to go, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to go 3, 2, 1, and I want you to say Horse Commander 3, and I'm going to time it, okay?
Okay.
So 3, 2, 1.
Horse Commander 3.
Okay, 1.13 seconds. Okay, 1.13 mm-hmm. seconds. Now, I'm going to say 3, 2, 1. I want you to say Red Dead Redemption. 3, 2, 1.
Red Dead Redemption 2.
Ooh, 1.30. I think the two saved you.
Put it just over.
I think you just over. I've already forgotten what the first one. No, I do think Red Dead Redemption 2 does take longer than Horse Commander 3. You're lucky that it's two. That's really what saved you and made it so that you are making the more efficient choice by saying Horse Commander 3.
When I type in Xfinity Horse Commander 3 in quotes, I get two results on Google. Both of them, though, when I click on them, they take me to like sort of a dangerous dead end of the internet, so I'm not going to go too far in it. But I think what both of these are, they're from something called WTOP, which I'm guessing is a radio station that is airing these commercials and then probably transcribing it in some way. And I've found some corner of the internet that is transcribing the broadcast signal, probably, and it's, they refer to it as Tom. I swore the commercial said Todd, but apparently the kid says Tom can barely play a full round of Horse Commander 3. Luckily, we get fast, reliable internet from Xfinity. So, anyway, that is Horse Commander 3.
Speaking of the weird corners of the internet, I was freaking out yesterday because I turned my laptop on. And I couldn't go to any websites. It kept saying that this website is not private. Mm-hmm. And I was like, what? And then it was like the New York Times, you know what I mean? And like just the websites that I tend to go to the most, and it was having some problem with the SSL. Have you ever had this happen where every website you try to go to, and I've tried it on Chrome, I tried it on Safari, everything, any website I was trying to go to was telling me it's not private, basically like you're in danger going to this website. Mm-hmm. And I was like, oh, is this the virus?
Yeah.
Is this a virus that's now telling me I can't go to any websites? But I also couldn't Google it because it wouldn't let me go to Google. It wouldn't let me do anything. And I was like, oh, you got to be kidding me. And so then on my phone, I had to look up, what is this? This website is not private, SSL, da da da. And then finally it said, it may be that your computer doesn't know what time it is. And I looked, and sure enough, it had the timing was off because my computer, for some reason, thought it was 1970.
Your computer suddenly was huge. It took up an entire room, and it was spitting out a roll of paper.
It was playing chess against Garry Kasparov. It was like, I was like, it was the strangest thing. I was, because I thought, oh, well, maybe it's off by a day or it didn't update for daylight saving or something. Like, what? Like, it was like, no, 1970. Like, it was like, it thought it was January 11th or so. Like, it was off, you know, multiple things were off. But my thought was, why does this even go back to 1970?
Mm-hmm.
Why is that even a possibility? What is the, whatever would be the utility for that? Why would your computer ever even have the possibility to think it was 50 years ago?
Yeah, that is I mean, there must be a reason for it, and I just don't know what it is. But did I tell you that, like, the computer that I used in college, which was not connected to the internet, it was an old 486. I'm trying to think of the manufacturer that made 486s, but a very early Windows computer that I think was running like Windows
Intel?
3.0. Maybe, but Intel would have been Intel's inside, but I don't think that's the maker of the entire computer. But anyway, everybody was worried about Y2K, and then for most people, Y2K
compact?
Ended up, maybe.
I'm just reading things on the internet.
Yeah, it seems about right. But anyway, I had a little computer that I just used mostly as a word processor and maybe played Free Cell on or something, but I wrote all my computer papers on it or whatever, and then I would like save it to a disk and take it into work to email or print out or whatever. That thing, when I came back from New Year's night celebrations early in the morning, got back to my apartment very bleary-eyed at like 3 a.m. and booted up my computer, instead of just going to bed and passing out like I probably should have, my computer didn't work. I had to I spent hours going into the BIOS and like changing the internal clock on it. So I was like, so if this computer was an airplane flying in the sky right now, it would have crashed. Like, my computer literally did get confused by the turning over of the calendar.
Wow. But it wasn't Y2K
related, yeah, because it was New Year's night, you know, it was like the earliest hours of New Year's Day, and I turned on my computer, and it's like, no, I'm not a computer anymore. I've been Y2K'd, essentially. And
the one person, all of that hype.
Exactly. And that, I got it working again, because I remember I brought it to New Hampshire with me, like, this is my first job. I still had that thing and I didn't even have the internet, I think, for a while at home when I took
that first job in radio, but I still had my old 486 set up in my living room, and it didn't do much. But yeah, I had to go into the BIOS and change internal clock settings and do all this weird stuff to get my old computer to still work.
This is where you and Walt are so similar.
I know, it sounds
so
like
similar.
It.
And you know what? I'll give you both credit. You usually get a good outcome, and I always think more my dad than you, but I always think he's insane because because it's like he'll when something. I mean, it's amazing. I didn't just throw this computer into the snow yesterday. All I had to do was finally get to the clock and just reset it. But like. When something, this just shows you my mentality in life, which is not a good one, which is like, if something isn't working and I've tried to like, I've turned it on and off, then it's just like, well, this is broken. This will never work. And it's like, well, probably it will. If you, my dad's always like you, always in the drivers, always hanging out in the drivers of things.
Drivers are so, I find them so scary and to mess with, because I always feel like I've been trained that like if you mess up a driver install, like forget about it, then you do have to burn everything to the ground. I think I'm exaggerating that, but drivers scare me, but I do have to spend time in that area.
Well, it's always Apple stuff with my dad. And like we had a moment, we should wrap things up, everyone needs to get on with their life here, but it's funny because I was talking, you know, last week or a couple weeks ago about kind of my dad sort of buying up used HDMI cables, which may or may not be functional. He finally broke down and got a new MacBook Air, which is the computer that I tend to use. I love the computer. It's very portable. It has plenty of processing for doing the normal things that we do, which is like emailing each other and whatever, a little bit of audio stuff. Of course, my dad, though, doesn't go to the Apple website and buy one. He buys it on Amazon refurbished. And I was like, how much did you pay for that? And he got all the Apple care. And I was like, how much did you pay for that? And I forget what the number was, but it was literally the exact same price as just buying it from Apple.
What?
And I didn't really have the heart to tell him because he was still reeling from the HDMI cable situation. Mm-hmm. So I didn't want to be like I was, you know. But the problem he was having was when he bought the computer, the battery, it would take like a week for the battery to charge up to like 60%. And then it would just start going down again. Like he could never get the battery power to 100%. He could like never, you know, and then when he did get it up to 60%, it just would like start dying really rapidly. I was like, this is a bum computer. I'm just thinking like, Dad, this is a bum computer, which you like didn't buy through Apple. So you're like, you know, this is the like, you know, Travelocity of computers. Like you're not going to be able to get Apple to help you because you didn't buy it from them. Like, anyway, he's on the phone with Amazon and he's trying to explain the and I was just like, he's in the other room and he's called like the Amazon, the number that you call at Amazon if they like, if you ordered a Swiffer and it showed up was wrong. You know what I mean? Like, he's not talking to a computer expert.
I can't believe Amazon has a phone number.
They do, but I will tell you this, it does not seem to terminate in the United States. So you're calling somebody who's in a different part of the world, who's there equally to help you with what your issues are with your computer as if you bought a cat treadmill like I did. And you just can't, it's like a restaurant that serves every kind of food. You can't know about all of those things. Like, and I'm just like, and he's in there explaining that the battery, it doesn't have battery power. I'm like, Dad, you're just yelling into the wind right now. You're like, you're talking to a person who has absolutely no expertise in computers. They're just answering a phone when someone has an issue with an Amazon product that they've received. And I hear him talking to the person, and it's really crazy because I'm like, just tell him you're sending it back. And then he goes, well, the battery is getting some more life. Now he's looking at the computer, and he goes from being like, he's not mean to the person, but he's just like obviously pretty disappointed about this whole thing. Oh, because he also, when he gets a new computer or a computer, he loads like 8 million sign related programs onto it and things, and like it's like 2 days for him to get the computer all loaded up with his shit, and then if the computer's a bum one, he's gonna take it all off and send it in. It's like the poor guy, he's Charlie Brown trying to kick the football. And I hear him in the conversation eventually switch up to, well, it seems like it's getting a little more battery power, so how about this, I'm gonna see what it does today, and then if it's not working, I'm gonna call you guys back and we'll have to get this worked out. And of course, the person on the other end of the line is like, great, cool.
Yeah.
I don't have to deal with this right now.
Yeah.
Sweet. And so I'm just thinking, Dad, what is this thing you're doing? Like, you're just going to have to call them tomorrow. Well, when I tell you, Andrew, that the battery somehow from making that phone call started holding a charge and went to 100%. And then for the next 6 days that my dad was here, the computer works great, maintained its charge. Every like hour, he would just let out a, I totally forget what was going on. He just let out a triumphant yop. And I'd be like, what's going on? He's like, the computer battery, it's at 85%.
Mm-hmm.
It's holding its charge. Somehow the universe just fixed this laptop battery so my dad does not have to mail it back. And it's totally like, it just, it's working now, which, have you ever heard in the history of computer stuff something like that happening?
Jalapeno! Jalapeno!
Where it's just like, I don't know, it wasn't working and now it works fine.
I mean,
I just don't feel like that stuff happens.
Of, I mean, I've had mystery. Yes, I, to answer your question without taking the fun away, like I had, speaking of drivers, when I bought the Dell that I'm using now, which I did buy new, like I was having so many issues and I can't remember the details, and that's probably for the best for the sake of this program. But there was something that was sort of driver related. I uninstalled it and reinstalled it a million times and it's still, I think, it was my internet, like the internet adapter in the computer, just like it was slowing things down. It was just totally like it's like strangling my internet speeds, and I went so deep on this, and I like worked on it for months, and then like suddenly it just started working again. And I don't know, like, you know, when you've turned something off and on and reinstalled it a million times, it's kind of hard to see exactly what ended up being.
Right. I start from that point, by the way.
Yeah.
Like, I start from being like, this is hopeless.
Right.
You had to go through, like, a lot of work to be like, this might be hopeless.
Which was really frustrating, but then I always remind myself, like, oh, but I actually know more about X, Y, or Z now than I did before I started. So there's always sort of, like, a little bit of a nerdy payoff for me on that. But I will say, like, as much is like, as you tell more and more stories about your dad's relationship with technology, like that, I totally see myself in those stories as well. One thing that is a huge difference, though, is like when it's time for me to buy a new computer, like I'll limp things along forever, right? You and I were having a conversation off air the other day. Like I got a couple of computers here that one was already retired. It was like it was in another room. It was supposed to only be used for like streaming baseball games upstairs if and when I could get it to work. That is the computer that I'm talking to you on right now, because when APM told me to send in the computer that they had issued me, I suddenly needed a computer. I was gonna buy a new one or maybe a used one just because this computer doesn't have to do a lot of stuff. It just needs to dial up with you every day. But I temporarily pulled this guy out of retirement, and then I think I told you and John that I did a full like factory rewipe on it, a restart on it, and now it's working fine. And this thing is like should have been retired a long time. I should have taken this, not unlike Horse Commander 3, I should have taken this behind the stable years ago and just put it out of its misery. So I will limp things along for a long time. But when I'm buying like a new phone or a new computer, like something that is going to be my main piece of technology, I never want it to be used. And I never even want it to be like a new but old generation. Like technology keeps moving so quickly. If you're going to take the time to invest in the new piece of equipment, I always want the latest version of it. I'm never looking for a deal, you know?
Yes. And that's where I always, like I said, want to like just gently put my arm around my dad and be like, how much hassle is this going to create in your life that you're buying the like 3-year-old version of this? Like, God bless him. My dad's the guy, when you get in his truck, his stereo system is a decommissioned iPhone that he bought just to put music on.
Oh, that's kind of
funny. He had to do some crazy, like, there, it wasn't just like it's an old iPhone. Like he was explaining to me what he had to do in order for this to function. Maybe it had been his iPhone, but then he just wanted it to be his iPod.
Yeah, actually, that I can see doing.
He like steampunked it into being like, you know, it's got like a small paddle wheel on it now that just like the river power. But yeah, he loves
for some reason he can watch Father Downey Mysteries on it.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, I will say, part of me is very happy that I can watch whatever television I want now. I can go back to my Dateline NBC ways, but I also miss watching Shetland with that dude.
Yeah.
Like, I keep having these thoughts of like, oh, it's almost time for Shetland. And then I realize, no, I can't watch Shetland because you know, that's a special Walt and Luke viewing. So anyway. All right, you know, I see my neighbor Bob carrying a door onto my front porch. This is a real thing that just happened. I think because they accidentally delivered it to his house. I've got a whole situation with Home Depot now that I've got to iron out. I think I may have an ill-gotten door. The other day they delivered, this is before all the snow, they delivered this door that I needed, but it wasn't at my house. And I went and looked on my neighbor's front porch and didn't see it. I don't know where the heck it went, but I called them and I said, you did not deliver it, and they recredited my credit card. And now I just saw, Bob is not the snow plower, Bob's the other guy. I just saw Bob coming down my stairs with this door in his arms. So now
Maybe he stole your front door. You got to go check this out.
Andrew, you call 911. I'm going to go take her.
Okay.
All right. Thanks for listening, everyone. We're going to be back here tomorrow with more imaginary radio for you. In the meantime, have a good Monday. Take care of yourselves. Stay warm and dry wherever you might be. And please remember, no mountain too tall.
And good luck to all.
Power out.